Coming up on today's show, Marvel Rivals is a thing, and I get to talk about Baldur's Gate 3 and more Final Fantasy IX rumors, baby. What's good, everybody, and welcome to another episode of the What's Good Games podcast, your source for video game news, commentary, analysis, and funny stuff every Friday. I'm one of your hosts, Brittany Brombacher, joined by the gorgeous, stunning Riana Manuel-Peña.
Oh. Oh, stop it.
Oh, girl.
I actually put on makeup today.
Girl, you, I know. I feel like I haven't seen you in far too long.
I know. It's been a while, but hey, we're here and we're holding it down.
We're here and we're matching. We are matching.
It's video games, not video games.
I can see it on your screen. Your beautiful, whatever's underneath that gorgeous shirt of yours. We all know what you're working with, baby. And I love it. It's kind of fun because we got these at PAX East last year.
Mm-hmm. We did, from the Mighty Yell booth. So Mighty Yell is a game developer that we love. And it's really funny that they had the shirt because they had the two different versions of it. One where video games is spaced out at the beginning and then all one word at the second one. And then they had the reverse as well.
Yeah.
And so it's just interesting, like an A-B test to see which one sells out first.
I will say whenever I wear this shirt, I always get a comment on it. Last time I wore it, I was flying and the TSA agent was like, "What's that all about?" I was like, if you don't understand, you are not worthy, don't you?
If you know, you know, guys.
If you know, you know. It feels good to be back, friends. Andrea is out this week, so Ria and I, like she said, we're holding it down. We're doing the damn thing. We have some fun things to talk about and some very Brit-esque stories that, Ria, I'm so excited you're here because you get to listen to me just kind of go off and do my Brit thing. It's going to be fantastic. Some housekeeping for you. If you have not heard, which I'm sure you have by now, we have moved to Supercast. That is whatsgoodgames.supercast.com. You can head over there and get ad-free podcasts, exclusive content, bonus episodes, and much more. I know Andrea recently uploaded a video of her and I talking about our time with WikiFeet. Yes, that is the thing. Ria, are you on WikiFeet? No one voluntarily goes on WikiFeet, by the way.
I don't think I am. My feet aren't, like, out and about that often.
Okay.
I mean, like, sure, at, you know, the Target down the street, but not anywhere else.
And let me be very clear. We did not submit ourselves to WikiFeet. People submit. They just, like, go through all of your photos and videos and find your feet and upload it. It's a whole thing. You do, you friends. Yeah, let's just move on from that. Thank you to this month's super producers, Bored Ape Gamers Club, Faris Attieh, Justin, Joshua Franklin, Justin Foshee, and Punkdefied. And welcome to our Supercast community. So this hasn't been updated in a few weeks. We had GDC and whatnot. So I went through and wrote down every name. I'm going to go through these ASAP. Strap in. Everyone deserves our shout out. We appreciate y'all making the transition from Patreon to Supercast. So let's knock this out. We have Alexa Smith, Todd Brie, Casey Amoris, John Kivas, Andrew Cotton, Robert Craig Nielsen, Tommy Solan, Gretchen Carlson, Gabriel Oliveira, Joshua Flink, and Casey Burgess, Doc Brook, Andrew Allison McCartney, Chris Cobb, Elizabeth Sheridan, John Jennings, Gerald Shivers, Carly Mine, Justin Foshee, Brandon Gann, Caitlin Barta, David Portnoff, Gary Peck, Kevin Ellis, Adolf Camacho, Steve French, Andrew Kebble, Finn, Robert Freemering, Dewey Reese, Steven Somers, Kenneth Corey, Bertie, that's not me, Nick Garcia, Kilsamonte, Jessica Bloom, Kevin Yang, John Roberts, Sean Kavanaugh, Jira Angelica Scano, Randall Savage, Samantha Young, Kenda Alger, Peter Eustrom, Chadwick Cardenas, Kenneth Hubble, Brandon Hall, Noel DeForest, Patrick Landry, Gregor Serrano, Samantha Beagle, Marina Albina Alvarez. Okay, whatever. I fucked up half of those.
You know, I was going to help you, but it was honestly funnier,
girl,
to just let it flow.
You know, the best part of it is instead of copying and pasting these names like I should have, I manually wrote them down. Why? Who knows? I don't even
Makes
know.
Sense.
So now I just butchered them all, and I know I pronounced all of those wrong. Regardless, we appreciate your support on Supercast. Thank you all so much. And thank you to our new podcast reviewers. Here's to the crazy ones, Mr. Anderson's First, Michelle Paisley, and Dumps. And today's show is brought to you by whatsgoodgames.supercast.com. But we'll tell you more about that later. Ree, we knew this announcement was coming this morning, and we got the news, and I saw that you are very excited about this.
Oh, yes.
Lay it on me, baby.
We have a new superhero game, friends. Marvel Rivals was announced. It's a 6v6 team-based free-to-play shooter set across the multiverse, and this is from IGN. So NetEase and Marvel Games have now announced Marvel Rivals, a 6v6 team-based free-to-play shooter headed to PC that stars iconic heroes and villains from the Avengers, Guardians of the Galaxy, X-Men, and much more. While there's no release date, NetEase and Marvel did reveal that Marvel Rivals will have a closed alpha test in May, just right around the corner. It also shared that this multiversal adventure will feature an initial roster comprised of Black Panther, Doctor Strange, Groot, Hulk, Iron Man, Loki, Luna Snow, Magic, Magneto, Mantis, Namor, Penny Parker, Rocket Raccoon, Scarlet Witch, Spider-Man, Storm, Star-Lord, and The Punisher.
Oh, is that, does that lineup right there alone get you hot and bothered?
It doesn't, it doesn't. There's okay. There's a handful of people in here that we've seen many, many times. So I'm like, okay, fine. You know, the stables. However, I'm really excited for folks like Penny Parker and Magic to show up, who, like, if you know sort of like the extended, you know, Marvel Universe or Spider-Man properties or different comics, and you've seen these iterations in a lot of different examples of media, but not in a game altogether, that really excites me. So yeah, we'll see how it goes. Moving on for IGN's story, Marvel Rivals also promises ever-changing battlefields that will be destroyed by the hero's powers on display in each match. We've seen this before and we like it, no matter if it's in Asgard or other places. This isn't for show either, as you can destroy and reshape your surroundings to gain a tactical advantage over your foes. So unlike, let's say, Mortal Kombat, it's not just cosmetic, right? This is actually going to change the abilities that you have when you're fighting on your team against the other team. So that's interesting. Moving on again, the strategic thinking doesn't end there, as dynamic hero synergy, TM, will be available for those who find the right combination of characters. So for example, we see Rocket Raccoon can hop on Groot's back and become more powerful, and the Hulk can unleash a gamma energy at Iron Man for a massive attack. Great song. Much like other free-to-play games, Marvel Rivals will continue to evolve and gain new content as the seasons roll on. Free-to-play. Including new playable characters, maps, and much more. Each new season will also tell more of the story of Marvel Rivals, which was written by the NetEase writing team. So I'll put an asterisk right there and come back to it in a second. Okay. In this multiverse, Dr. Doom and his future self from the year 2099 are locked in a vicious battle that has caused countless universes to collide in the time stream entanglement, TM. To stop things from getting even worse, heroes and villains from across the multiverse must put their differences aside and band together to save everything we know and love. So coming back to that asterisk, I wonder what the NetEase team is referencing when they're coming up with this original storyline, because as you know, in the MCU, we've seen a lot of things about incursions and different universes bumping together and making ugly. And it'll just be, I'll be interested to see what parts of this align with the canon that we're aware of in other properties, and what NetEase is just kind of like going off on a tangent to do, because obviously you have to have a reason for every character to fight next to every other character.
Yeah, so this is one of those stories where I have nothing, because this is so not my jam, but I can see how it would be somebody's jam, someone's jelly, if you will, Ree, if this is the sort of thing you're into. But I do think it's really cool if they can pull off the balancing that you can have. You have this wide roster of characters to choose from, but then as we talked about that dynamic hero synergy TM, that you can link characters together to do certain combos. So it makes me wonder how efficient a team can be if you're not communicating when you're picking your roster. Is this a sort of game you can just like pick up and hop into and play casually? I mean, I'm sure it is, but to be really good, you have to have a team of six.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's interesting because we've seen examples like Apex and then other games like Fortnite have picked this up, where there's sort of like dynamic smart pinging systems that players who aren't verbally communicating or typing to their teammates can take advantage of, where they ping something in the world and the character makes a comment about it to communicate to the other teammates. I wonder if they'll do something like that in order to make it a little bit more accessible for people who are solo queuing or just going in as a duo or something like that, to communicate with their teammates to find that synergy. What's really cool is that we see this happening organically in games like Overwatch, where people are, you know, combining different characters and different heroes in order to find some optimal way to approach an enemy situation, or if there's different objectives during the team 6v6 gameplay, which we don't know yet. Like what works well together, right? I know we recently have been excited about X-Men 97 online, and there's some examples of really amazing team fighting in that cartoon. And I'm hoping that they have something for every combination, but I don't know. It'll be interesting to see how well those match up and if some are stronger than others, some apply to certain situations, but not everyone. Mm-hmm. And, you know, if people get locked into their favorites, like a certain man that I know that I play games with a lot always picks Bangalore whenever we play Apex.
Who would that be?
Maybe we don't always need the smoke. Just saying. Like, hopefully people are a little more flexible and we can figure out the best team comps to win every single game.
So as someone who, again, like this superhero things, PvP, whatever, totally not my thing. As an outsider to this whole niche, do you, I guess like my initial reaction is I totally understand being excited for this. And I totally understand that we all want this to succeed. We never want to see games fail. Do you think there is room for a free-to-play 6v6 superhero team-based shooter to thrive and succeed in the state of the industry that we're in today?
That is an excellent question. And the answer is always yes, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. There's always room for another banger. What there isn't room for is something that is felt to be disrespectful of a player's time, mm-hmm. right? And with free-to-play, it's really tricky because you can jump in, it's low stakes, but does it feel super grindy? Does it pay off within, you know, the first 30 minutes? Do you feel like you have to pay in order to be competitive? Those are the questions right. that will really ultimately answer whether or not this game is viable in today's landscape, because we've seen new games pop out and thrive, like Hello Helldivers, which is not free,
yeah,
right? And it felt like maybe extraction shooters were kind of waning, but turns out when things are done well and done right, the audience will find it. So we'll have to kind of wait and see. But the initial excitement has been really positive so far.
Yeah, yeah. So it sounds like it's on PC now. It's going to go into alpha in May. And I'm assuming that's when they're going to, I think they said alpha, right? I didn't make that up.
I heard that, yeah.
Okay, that they're going to hopefully work out the balancing. Because any game like this, especially when you have like this many big characters, you know, yeah. people just, I hope folks are patient. Our attention spans are so short these days that when they hop in, and hopefully they can work these kinks out in alpha. But I know even with Smash Brothers, even with like Pokemon Unite, for example, you know, there's always balancing and they're always nerfing or they're always buffing. And then that generally will break something. So it's just going to be kind of interesting to see, you know, especially with characters so beloved like this, every person who associates with a character is going to want their skills, you know, their special moveset to be so true to them. And if they feel weaker than they should, then that's going to cause some problems. But very cool. I mean, I hope this works and I hope everyone makes tons of money and can feed their families and has a job for more than 6 months.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, we love all of that for all developers. Yeah,
everybody everywhere. There's one more story I wanted to talk about, and this is, before we move on to little Brit stories, if you will, before we take our first break, this is BioShock's Ken Levine reveals more details on his narrative Lego game, Judas. So this comes from VGC. So a select outlets got to go play Judas, which is again Ken Levine's new game, for about 5 to 6 hours, I think is what I saw. And
good chunk.
Oh yeah, that is a good chunk. So VGC kind of looked through most of those articles, IGN and Jeff Keighley's impressions, and compiled a little summary of it, because IGN has a very, very extensive interview with Ken on their website. So if you're into that, absolutely check it out. But it probably would have taken me 30 days and 30 nights to read it. So I'm opting for the VGC route. So new information on Judas, the next game from BioShock creator Ken Levine, has emerged. Levine Studio, is it Levine or Levine? It's Levine, isn't it?
I thought it was Levine.
I'm just so bad with names. So we're going to go with Levine. I'm pretty sure that's what it is. If not, sue us.
Yeah.
The studio Ghost Story Games invited select media, like I said, including IGN and Jeff Keighley, to play the game for 5 to 6 hours. So IGN's report calls the game a, quote, first-person narrative-driven shooter that, from a moment-to-moment gameplay perspective, will feel familiar to BioShock fans. Surprising no one. The protagonist is Judas, a formerly dead but now reprinted woman aboard a city-sized spaceship called the Mayflower. The ship is transporting the last survivors of the human race from Earth to a new planet called Promia Centauri. Judas has interactions with the ship's three leaders. This is where it gets kind of interesting. Tom Nefertiti? God, what's up with me and getting all the names today, Ri? It's like, here, bitch, get back in the saddle. We give you all these names.
I think it's Nefertiti.
Nefertiti, thank you. Nefertiti. And Hope. Nefertiti from my bunghole. Anyway, and the player has to decide which ones to help, because making one leader happy may upset another one, in a structure Levine calls, quote, narrative Lego. Keeley posted his first impressions on a video on X, saying the game still feels like a Bioshock game to some extent. Quote, all the things you'd expect in a Bioshock game are there. There are hand powers, there's hacking, there's incredible cinematic moments, great characters, rich storyline, but there's something more going on behind the scenes, and this is something that's really hard to describe or showcase in a trailer. Keeley also notes that the game is not done by any means, although it was reported back in October 2020 that Levine's next game was entering the later stages of production. Granted, October 2020, very different landscape for this world that we were in. A lot of weird things with COVID were going on. So, Ria, what's your history with Bioshock? I know you've told me before, but can you remind me?
Yeah, so I played Bioshock's late, right? Okay. Infinite was the only game that I played when it released, and then I had to backtrack in order to catch up. So I have a very recent history with Bioshock, but I didn't grow up with it as like a nostalgic game.
Got it. And I know Bioshock is one of Andrea's absolute favorite franchises, and I really enjoyed him too. Actually, the first Bioshock was too scary for me, believe it or not, back in the day. Mm. It was a little too tense. So I also got into it a little bit late. But man, like, this seems good. I don't care if Judas, it feels just like Bioshock. I'm ready for another game like Bioshock. There's just something about it that's so unique, from the gameplay to the powers to just the vibe of that world of Rapture, that I am just very, very stoked that it sounds like we're getting more info, and maybe we're even closer to getting this game, although it sounds like it might be a little ways out still. I wouldn't really want anything too different from, like I was saying earlier, like the OG Bioshocks. I just, again, I think they're great as they are. But this Tom Nefertiti and Hope, and how the player has to decide which leaders to help, because making one leader happy may upset another one. That's interesting. Narrative Lego. But I will say, and I don't know if it's just because of where I'm at in my life right now, but I don't want to manage relationships, whether they're fiction, especially if they're fictional. You know what I mean? Like, I feel like I'm just more like at this point, just ready to be like, go fuck yourselves. You know what I mean? Figure your own shit out. I'm going to just do what's good for me. Is that bad?
I don't think so. Okay. I mean, I think it's cool that we're at a stage in game, I guess, zeitgeistdom where, you know, all of these different narrative elements affecting the outcome of the story, that excites me. And I like seeing more of it. Like, there's another game coming soon, The Altars, that does something similar. I think it's in early access on Steam right now or soon or something like that, where, you know, you're talking to clones of yourself. Very different game. But the conceit is that, you know, if you please one NPC, another might have thoughts about it. And we've seen this in many different
games, real life,
right? Like, yeah, exactly. Like, Lee will remember that. it's very appealing to me, because one of the things I love the most about video games is the interactive storytelling. Mm-hmm. And when they say it's a rich story, I'm like, oh, okay, so that means there's a lot of twists and turns. We can expect that from a Bioshock-esque game. Mm-hmm. And I get really into it. And when things are a little bit too scary for me and I'm playing, like, sort of like peeking out of the corner of my hand, that's what keeps me going. And I just want to unlock more of it and figure out more about what these characters are doing and what their motivations are. And, you know, ultimately if they're good or evil, if I align with them or not. And I feel like this is right up my alley. I just hope it's not too hard. Because honestly, if they've only played 5 and 6 hours and the game still hasn't quite opened up, long games are tough for me right now. I'm just not in a long game place. I need quick in and out experiences.
That is what she said.
I don't have the memory to recall all of everybody's rich histories. We'll see if this is for me in the long run, but I like the idea of it.
Amen to that, girl. Like, there's one of the features I love the most right now are those in-game encyclopedias. We saw it in Final Fantasy 16. It was in Rise of the Ronin. I'm like, thank you. Give me, I want to know what this person ate for breakfast. I want to know what time they took a shit. Like, I want to know everything, because I'm going to come back to it and I'm not going to remember who the hell they are. So I love that more games have been including that in them. But yeah, no, I agree with everything you said. And it's just hard to believe that Infinite came out in like 2014. And now here we are 10 years later. Right?
Yeah.
Jesus, wheeze. Wow. I don't know. I don't know what's happening real time. But very excited to see what Ken comes up to. He's a very, very intelligent man. And he comes up with some wacky ass shit. So
If anything else, I love watching someone else play it.
Oh, there you go. You can have Danny play it, and you can peek out with your eye.
Mm-hmm.
That's maybe. I know a game you and I need to play together. Outlast Trials.
Absolutely not.
I will always shoot my shot. I will always. One of these days, she's just going to look at me, and you're going to cave, and you're going to be like, yeah, girl, I got you.
You know, I appreciate your tenacity, but the little sleep that I do get, I need it to be restful, not filled with nightmarish creatures.
Oh God, that game. That, even for me, I was like, okay, this is enough. yeah. Well, that's going to do it for our first two stories. When we come back after this break, I have some Brit-ass shit to talk about, and thank you, Ri, again, for being along for this ride. We'll be right back. What a fitting week for me to be on the show, friends, because I have some Baldur's Gate 3 stuff to talk about. I have some Final Fantasy 9 stuff to talk about. So let us just get right into it.
Lettuce.
Okay, first of all, shout out to Kat Bailey and Rebecca Valentine, because they had a huge interview with Sven, I like to call him Sven, big boss man at Larian Studios, because he had a talk at GDC called The Secrets of Baldur's Gate 3, and they compiled this huge interview, and then they broke off a bunch of little mini articles from that interview. So absolutely recommend you check it out. He talks about a whole bunch of stuff, but I just want to talk about some of the highlights that I thought were really interesting from that interview. So Larian started work on Baldur's Gate 3 DLC, then canceled it. Quote, the studio was elated, which is a spicy headline, but that's exactly what he said. So some of the highlights from this interview, Larian isn't planning to release any expansions or DLC for Baldur's Gate 3, nor make a Baldur's Gate 4. Instead, Sven said at the panel, Larian plans to move away from Dungeons & Dragons entirely and do something new, leaving the IP and publisher Wizards of the Coast hands. He later said in a subsequent interview with IGN that their next project will be, quote, different than what you think it is, but that it still is familiar. So I'd love to hear from you on this, Ri, because something that I've just picked up from like my time doing video game coverage and whatnot is it's so important for devs to be able to do something new and do something different and challenging. And I just saw some folks from the Remedy team talking about this with their Project Condor, the multiplayer stuff that's coming out, that a lot of folks were like, oh, no one wants this. No one needs this. And then they're like, no, this is good for us. Like, we need to expand our wings and challenge ourselves in order to grow and innovate and not have things remain stale. So I think this is just something we don't see that often, right? You don't see where a game makes $90 million in revenue for Hasbro, I think is what it was. And then, yeah. Then they'd just be like, okay, we're done. Like, we're ready to move on. We're ready to do something different. And if you read the interview more, essentially, he was like, I went on vacation at Christmas time and I came back and I was like, I don't have the energy for this. Like, I'm just not into it. And his team was like, thank you. Like, this is good. So, like, what's your take on that?
God, I love hearing it. That's music to my ears. Like, when your creative heart is not in something, like, don't spend billions of dollars making it, because it's gonna show that you didn't give a shit, you know? Like, yeah. You can't phone in stuff this big and pull it off the same way that you did when you were making a love letter to D&D, right? It's just not gonna match up. Mm-hmm. And I love seeing studios make a slight turn, right? Like, hello, Destiny. Like, we wouldn't have some of our favorite games right now if studios were forced or chose to keep doing the exact same thing over and over again. So make a slight turn, like, similar but different. I like that. I can't wait to see what it is, because Baldur's Gate 3 was too big for me at the time in my life with everything else that was coming out. And also being my third trimester.
Oh, yeah.
But if they did something else that's, like, familiar and maybe has slightly bigger text on a Steam Deck, and I can actually carve out time out of my days to play, I'm so excited, because I love what they've done. I love the reception. I love the love and care that they've given it to it. All of the actors are obsessed with this franchise. So, like, if they can pull the things that worked out of Baldur's Gate 3 and move it towards a new project that is familiar but a new IP, I'm so excited. And, you know, I love the idea that they would own this new IP, right? And they'd have a little bit more creative license to do all the wacky things that I know they were thinking of when they were doing Baldur's Gate that still didn't make it into that game much as it was in there. There's stuff on the cutting room floor. So let them, you know, take the ball and run with it, I say.
That's it. Yeah, I'm glad you brought that up too, because in the interview, he does go into detail about stuff that they did cut. Some really interesting kind of like behind the scenes stories. So again, if you're into it, definitely read it. And I love, again, like he says, it'll still feel familiar. And that's why I was so hyped on Baldur's Gate 3 from the get-go, is Divinity Original Sin 1 and 2 of my all-time favorite games. And Baldur's Gate 3 absolutely feels like a Larian game. It just has that thing to it, which is the gameplay and the quirks and the ability to do anything you want. So no matter what they make, and I think it's so cool that Larian's in this position, I think they can make anything and they're going to just have a trove of people behind them being like, we're in!
You know, yeah, at this point, we're Larian fans, not necessarily the IP fans.
Yes, thank you. That's absolutely it. And according to him as well, Hasbro and Wizards of the Coast is, quote, not to blame for Larian leaving Baldur's Gate 3 and D&D behind. Swin said, as for Baldur's Gate 3 and its characters, they now belong to Wizards of the Coast, and I think they understand how important they are for the community. I trust that they'll be treated with respect. This is also very interesting to me. And of course, like, we always hope for the best. We always want everyone to succeed. But I do not envy the team that inherits these characters if they do make another story or DLC or spinoff with them, because these characters have resonated with so many people very intimately. And, you know, when you take something or a gaggle of characters like this, and then it's like, okay, Larian made them, like, air quote, perfectly here. Good luck. Like, take them and run with them. I mean, we've seen it go both ways, right? Ask, you know, people have different opinions on the Halo franchise, what happened after, you know, went from, like, Bungie to 343, et cetera, et cetera. But, sure. Yeah, it's going to be just interesting to see what they do with that. And just, yeah,
I'm sure we'll get a Magic the Gathering pack. I mean, come on. It's right there.
Hell yes. I want all of the cards. I will collect all of the cards. And then as far as wrapping up patches and extra content going forward, you're not going to see a lot of additional content, but the team is still working on creating cinematic endings, particularly for the evil endings, because you can really fuck some shit up in that game. Mm. And I just think it's really cool that they are still taking the time to make sure that even if you are a bastard in this game, that you're going to get the ending that you deserve in terms of, like, how beautiful and gorgeous it will be. And also, he just has fascinating philosophy on game development and the state of the industry. And absolutely read it. You know, you can tell it was obviously an interview that was recorded. And so he gets really fired up at one point talking about, like, say, the game development and how greedy some of the people at the top are. And you can tell because his words just – and English isn't his first language, I don't believe. But, you know, he just, like, gets really fired up and really heated, which is so interesting because he's such a chill, passive guy. I mean, you know, the handful of times I've met him and hung out with him and whatnot – but yeah, you can tell in the interview, he's very passionate about the way developers are treated and the corporate greed. So again,
yeah,
love him.
I appreciate those words, and it's very true. You can't double your profits every single year, y'all. Yeah. It's not possible. So let's just focus on making good things and grow slow. Please.
Yeah, he literally said that too in the interview. He was like, you know, CEOs will be like, yeah, we made $1 billion this year. Next year, we're going to make $2 billion. He's like, all right.
It's like, dude, no, don't do that. Just make $1 billion again.
Yeah. A billion is fine. Could you imagine ever in our lives, Reed, being like, oh, we only made $1 billion this year in revenue. Oh, no, we must make two. Indies.
Whatever, late-stage capitalism is coming for all of us. Moving on.
Moving on to another Brit-ass story that I am just so excited. Okay. Final Fantasy IX Remake may have just been confirmed by Final Fantasy XIV's director. This comes from Screen Rant. I think this title is a little silly. Like, I don't think that's the case, but I'm rolling with it because it gets me hot and bothered. All right. Final Fantasy XIV director Naoki Yoshida may have just let the cat out of the bag. Yoshida announced at PAX East that the collector's edition of Final Fantasy XIV Dawn Trails expansion would include some extra items themed around Final Fantasy IX, prompting the director to elaborate that the reason behind all of the references was a secret. So the items are Final Fantasy IX's Arc Summon as a mount, wind-up Princess Garnet / Dagger minion, and if you pre-order Dawn Trail, you'll get a wind-up Zidane minion. Okay, Zidane's main character, Dagger, one of the main characters. And this is when, like, when I first saw this tree, I was like, oh my god, it's happening, like, this is it. And then everyone brought me back down to earth. And this makes sense. So, Screen Rant continues, it's entirely possible that Yoshida is dropping hints that the remake is closer than expected, but Final Fantasy XIV has previously hosted events themed around older games in the franchise. The critically acclaimed Endwalker expansion included plenty of content pulled from Final Fantasy IV and V, and neither of those games have received a ground-up remake aside from the Pixel Remaster. And then a bunch of other folks in the comments were like, not to bust people's bubbles, but this is probably just they're going to do something themed around Final Fantasy IX inside Final Fantasy XIV. To which I would still say, Rhee, said that is still a finger pointing to the direction of Final Fantasy IX Remake. I'm telling you.
Are you sure?
I'm 100% sure this game is happening. I would lay down, if I don't know what I would lay down for this, but I would lay down something for this, damn it. I would. I mean, if you just go back.
Maybe they're just throwing you a bone here.
No.
It's not going to happen. I want this for you. I do. I just don't see
it. How dare you? I love you. And I've always loved you. But you're lucky you're not right here with me, because I would never do that to you. I love you too much. No, I mean, real talk. Final Fantasy IX has been in the silent treatment for a very, very, very long time. But now you know, we have this animated series coming into fruition. We see it in marketing materials. We see the game, you know, paying special attention to certain anniversaries around Final Fantasy IX. Maybe I've talked to somebody within the industry who maybe confirmed something. Who could say? Who could say? Granted, that last time I talked to that person, it was like a year ago. That's okay, though, right? That still counts as something. There's also rumors from a, quote, reliable leaker. I also love how I have in my notes, reliable laker. Silkenith, this is what they said about the whole remake. From what I know, the main idea is a remake as it's going to be a remake as faithful as possible to the original and definitely much more modest than Final Fantasy VII in terms of budget. I'm not aware of the changes over time, but originally it was even planned for Nintendo Switch. Perhaps the project has been scaled up for the next console from Nintendo. It's understandable. Personally, I don't expect anything official in the short term either. So, that's okay. That's good. Listen, like, you got Final Fantasy VII out now. 16 is out. We're getting this Dawn Trail stuff out. Like, Final Fantasy IX needs its own, like, mound. I hate that word, mound. I can't believe I just said that. Anywho, I'm telling you, I am 100% convinced this is happening. It's just a matter of when. And whenever it happens, everyone better have their ponchos on because it's gonna get wet and messy. It's gonna be great. There she goes again. The little she's a little disgusted, but she acknowledges my emotions.
I hope that's true for you and for all the other poncho wearers. I want you all to have your wet, messy moments on your mounds.
Thank you, Ri. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Thank you. And on that lovely note, that's all I have for headlines this week. Ri, unless there's anything else you're like, I want to talk about this. It's just one of those, just one of those weeks, man. All right, well, we will move on and take another break. And when we come back, I have been playing a fun little game called Ship of Fools, and I'm excited to tell y'all about it. See you soon. Welcome back to the What's Good Games podcast. This is where we talk about what we've been playing and any preview events we may or may not have been to. I have not been playing a lot outside of... Okay, let me back up. This has been the year of single-player games for me so far, right? We started out with Infinite Wealth, then it went right into Final Fantasy VII Remake, and then into Rise of the Ronin, and then Dragon's Dogma 2, right? I'm living a good life. I mean, listen, I don't know how I did any of it, but I did. I played them. It's been great. It's been
quite the stretch.
It is quite the stretch. And so a couple days ago, Jason looked at me with like puppy dog eyes. And he was like, "Can we play video games again together?" Like, and I was like, "Yes, this is a good time to do it." I am playing Dragon's Dogma 2, but just kind of casually at this point. I miss playing games with him. So we went through our wish list that we've accumulated on Xbox, and we found a game called Ship of Fools, and this one just looked like it was going to hit the spot, and it absolutely did. So this game came out in 2022. It is developed by Fika Productions, and I think this is their only game as that studio, and published by Team 17. If you're interested in playing on Steam, it's actually on sale from now until April 4th for $8.79. So a nice little sale there. But otherwise, on Xbox and PlayStation, it's $21.99. And so I'm going to read the official blurb because I think they just did a better job at describing it. Quote, "A seafaring co-op roguelite where you play the fools, the only creatures fool enough to brave the sea. Together, you and your shipmate will jump aboard the Storm Strider and make your voyage across the sea. Man the cannons and protect your ship from sea monsters over multiple runs. It's up to you to defend your home." I went through puberty. "From the mighty aquapocalypse." Aquapocalypse, like water. Mm. Oh, yes. Yeah, so it's a very cute, unique take on a game. It's like a chill Overcooked, I would say. Yeah, because how it works is you have, there's several ships to choose from, but you have one and then you will eventually unlock another. And each ship kind of has pros and cons. And the point is to clear 3 roguelike maps, and then that's considered to be like one main run. Like, you've done the thing at that point. Obviously, you're not going to do that right away. You're going to die a lot. But you collect these things called tendrils along your voyages, and you use them at your base to upgrade your cannons. You can add health buffs. You can make it so you start with more money so you can buy more stuff when you're around the shops. I mean, it's kind of like a very, very, very light, if you've played Hades, if you've played Overcooked, you know, it's that sort of idea, but a very, very light version of that. And so each map, each area has a random like grid map, and each grid has a different encounter on it. So maybe it's you're going to go to a shop. Maybe it's an encounter with enemies. Maybe you'll get an artifact or a trinket, which will buff your skills for that particular run. And most of the time you'll know which grid contains what, but sometimes you won't. So you definitely have to be strategic. Like, are we going to do a tendril run where we just come back and we upgrade the shit out of our ship? Or are we going to collect artifacts and trinkets and actually try to get farther and maybe even complete a run? So it's fun to work together on that. And it's very like low intensity and low stress. It's just, you know, you're going to die a lot, but it's not that punishing. I think a final run we did was maybe 35 minutes. But again, okay. Yeah, it's about the progression, right? And every time you play, you unlock, you get better. You unlock new maps, you unlock new trinkets. I think there's over 100 different items that you can customize your ship with. But the combat is kind of where it gets fun and a little hectic. So you have two cannons at all times, but you have four different placements across the ship where you can put them. And you can pick them up and put them wherever you need to on the fly. And you're going to have to do that because you never know which side the enemies are going to come from. Are they going to come from the north? Are they going to come from the south? And sometimes enemies will land on the ship. And when they do that, you have to get off of the cannons and you have to go whack them on the ship. Eventually, you can also get cannons that auto-target and auto-fire. But of course, there's like a trade-off for that as well. And when your ship does become damaged, you have to replace it with planks that you'll find in the ocean, or maybe you'll find on a grid in the map, and that acts as the ship's health. It's a very cute game. Like, the replayability is there with different ships. You know, if you complete a run with the two starter ships, you unlock a new ship, and there's like harder difficulties you can unlock, buffs you can apply if you want to make the game more difficult if you want. But it kind of just hit the spot. You know, you just want something that kind of has a little bit of grind to it, but with progression. You know, when you're just like, I just want to sit here and chill and not have to think too much about it. We're going to die, but if we do, it's okay because we'll come back the next time stronger, literally. And it was just a nice cozy game to play. Nice and...
Yeah.
Yeah. So
nice little co-op moment. I love that Jason was like, I want to play games with you, please.
I know. And yeah, and to his credit, yeah, like I said, it's just been such a stretch with all these single-player games. You know? Not to mention, like, Dragon's Dogma is a beefy-ass game as well, and I haven't even finished... Rise of the Ronin. Actually, maybe I can talk about that for a few minutes. Do you have any interest in Rise of the Ronin? I know you said right now you're like, I'm more into indie stuff, smaller, bite-sized.
Yeah, that's definitely my vibe right now.
Yeah,
that's but it. I will get to it eventually. It's just, you know, backlog, maybe.
Oh, girl, I get it. I totally get it. Yeah, so if you listen to the review Andrea and I did for Rise of the Ronin, where I left off was I had just unlocked the second map of that game, and my concern was that I had this open world in front of me, and while I really enjoy the open world stuff from the first map, I was worried that the second one might start feeling too repetitive, and... That is exactly what happened. I got to the open world area. I started exploring. It looked beautiful. It looked gorgeous. But it was like, find X amount of cats. You know, do this, do that. I'm like, I just spent like 20 hours doing that. I don't really want to do that again in a new map. And so I haven't picked it back up since then. I still think the game is very fun. I still think if you're into the combat of it, you don't have to do the open world stuff. You know, if you want to feel powerful, like I feel very powerful and I didn't do anything in the second map. So it's just too bad because I feel like there was such a sweet spot for Team Ninja with that first part of the game. In terms of like, that's when it was the most dense, and that's when it, you know, if they really focused on the narrative and really kind of like honed in, it would have been, I think, a great length. But the fact that I was like 35 hours in and only a third of the way through because I spent so much time doing all the open world stuff, and then all of a sudden it's like, boom, here's two more maps with the same open world activities. It was just like, okay, I think I'm kind of burned out. So I'm taking a break from now. But I still stand by what I said, that in the sense that I'm glad that games like that exist. Not every game needs to break and surpass industry like AAA standards in order to be enjoyable. I think we forget that. I think it's like, if we're having fun and we're enjoying ourselves, you know, a 7, 7.5, 8 out of 10, whatever your scaling rank is, that's still like, that's fine and that's good if you're having a good time. And I think a lot of folks were just kind of harsh on it because it does a lot of recycled stuff. Maybe not particularly the best you've seen, but it was still fun. So maybe I'll get back to it. Maybe I won't. We'll see. I don't know. There's a lot of other stuff coming out right now. I think the next game we're going to play read together, Jason and I, is Baldur's Gate 3. I think we're finally going to do it.
Nice.
Help us. I like that. It's going to take us forever.
Oh, God.
It's going to take forever. Yeah. But, I mean, that's all I got for this week's episode. Like I said, unless you have some groundbreaking shenanigans, I see in the show notes, actually, you did put Love and Pies.
Yeah, so I can talk about this very quickly. Okay. Because I haven't been paid to talk about it. But of course, I have a little baby, and mm-hmm. I spend a lot of one-on-one time with her doing mommy things. So I need a one-hander kind of game for my phone. And Love and Pies has been my latest mobile game phenomenon. Found it because I watch a tiny house video channel. Shout out to Living Tiny.
I love it.
They actually had a paid ad on it. And I was like, oh, okay, well, this channel doesn't usually do game ads. So let me check it out. So I downloaded it. It's okay. So cute. It's a match game, the kind of game where, like, I have two bowls of flour. I put them together. Now I have a cookie. I put two cookies together. Now I have a cupcake, right? Aww. So it's that kind of a match game. You have a grid, you have limited spaces on your grid, so there's some strategy and what things you try to match up now versus waiting later once you have more room to add more ingredients to your grid. There's, of course, pay mechanics to speed up your timers, to add more energy, all of those things. So I'm not going to recommend it for people who tend to get down a spending hole, because it's very easy to be like, oh, let me just buy some more gems, or let me just speed up this timer.
Sure.
And it'll nickel and dime you. Like, I will give you the warning. It is meant to do that. Mm. It is one of those games. But it has a really cute story and very good animation and, like, some fun writing. And there's, like, a cute little kid and a dog, and there's a love story and a murder mystery and, oh, like, a rival bakery. Like, so there's a lot more to it story-wise than I was expecting. Plus, you get to decorate and outfit your bakery and upgrade different rooms as you continue on the story and get more coins and progress. So there's more to it than just the matching aspect, which, you know, if I'm sitting there for 20, 30 minutes in a row, I get bored. And so I can go back and forth between the match game and the story. Mm-hmm. So I would say it's fine. I'm not going to give it like a seal of approval because it does have some gotcha elements to it, but it's very easily managed. So yeah, I've been playing Love and Pies. I like it a lot. It's very cute. If they made a plushie, I'd probably buy it.
It looks really cute. I'm looking at pictures of it. Yeah. I love the little decorating. Aw.
Yeah.
It's so cute. I'm glad it's games like this exist too. Sometimes, like, you just need this. You get your fix out of it. It serves its purpose, mm-hmm. and then you move on.
Yeah. Just, you know, don't click on the ads. It's as simple as that. Yeah. A couple other games I wanted to shout out from a few things. Like, I have my ongoing list of games I'm watching out for. Shout out to the Future Game Showcase that IGN did with what's his face? Our friend Ben Starr and Samantha Baird. They did a great job. Oh. And they were hosting, but I was mostly just watching to write down games, but they were distracting me because they were so funny. a few things that I'm looking forward to. There's this game. I already mentioned Alters is on my list. Mm-hmm. There's another one. It's Space Prison. On April 10th. That's coming out soon.
Okay, to Google.
It's like a roguelite where essentially you're trying to escape from prison in space. And anytime you die, it's like, oh, failed attempt. But you still have to serve out your sentence. So they print a new body for you and you go inhabit the new body. Very fun roguelite conceit. That looks cool. There's also Faro North, which is a little bit later. It's in August on Xbox, PC, and Switch. That one looked interesting to me. What is this? There's a new Gun Fu game called Spine, which it seems sort of super hot kind of esque game, but not in VR. Mm. And that one caught my eye as well. So there's a couple that are on my list. I have a much longer list, of course. I can go over that another day. But I'm curious to know if people can write in what you're all looking forward to, because I'm trying to prioritize my spring and my summer gameplay. And I need to populate this list very strategically this year. So let me know what everybody's interested in. And if there's anything that you think would be up my alley, and I'll check it out.
Yeah, I know. I was thinking about that too. You know, a game I was actually kind of interested in was that Botany Manor game.
Yeah,
I've been seeing a lot of press releases about it, but it looks like just mm-hmm. a game where you just fucking manage plants and shit, which, like, you know what I mean?
Right.
Right? I mean, I'm sure there's a lot more to it than that, but it just sounds like super duper duper chill. And other than that, like, Paper Mario coming out in May. I'm looking at GameSpot's upcoming games right now.
Oh, yeah, they have a great list.
They do, yeah. Stellar Blade looks like, that could be an interesting one, if mm-hmm. not just for the beautiful woman.
No Rest for the Wicked is definitely on my playlist, and that's Steam Early Access soon, I think in a couple weeks.
Oh, and you're also looking forward to that Tales of, is it Kinzera?
Tales of Kinzera Zao. Yeah. Absolutely. That's already on my list.
That's already on your 100%. List. Okay, you got that on there. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, other than that, it's just, it's going to be I'm very curious to know what the rest of this year is going to look like.
Yeah.
Just kind of looking through, it's like, what's happening? What's happening this fall, man?
What's going on?
Are we getting that PS5 Pro?
We still have a lot of announcements to get.
I know. We got Summer Game Fest. The Nintendo Switch 2 apparently is coming next year. But yeah, it's going to.
This Xbox handheld rumor.
Oh, I hope that happens. I'm
I need it.
So on board with the handheld. And I think, you know, especially now that it's hard to sit down and play games, right? It's just, mm-hmm. it's hard with little children. But when you're in bed, you got your PlayStation Portal, you got your Steam Deck. I mean, I have all of my handhelds just like by my nightstand.
Just like lined up.
Yeah, just lined up. Like, ooh, what am I doing tonight? I just bought a Kindle free. I've been reading.
Ooh.
Ooh, I know. I don't even know who I am anymore. I got a new bird feeder. Like, who? What?
Oh my God.
I just, you know what, like, I feel like I'm turning into, like, I don't know what. I know,
I
like,
love this.
Girl, I have, like, a bird book next to my window. I don't know what's going on. I think
Do you have bird watching binoculars?
I don't, because the bird feeder is right next to my window.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we got a woodpecker the other day. That was really exciting. You know, it's just, like, I think I'm just coping with life, and I'm happy. I'm doing good.
I love it. When you start growing your own vegetables, like, that's going to be
complete the whole set. I tried that like 3 years ago and I realized it's a bad idea. I can keep my child alive and a few house plants and my dog, but vegetables, like, it's that object permanence. Like, if I don't see it, it doesn't mm-hmm. exist. So
fair.
Needless to say, I didn't grow any pumpkins that year. That was not good.
Aww.
Yeah. No. It's okay, though. It's fine. I you know, I'm keeping the kid alive, so I'm happy about that.
Yes, we all are.
Yes. Well, this has been super fun. I'm glad that I got to come back. I wish Andrea is here, but I'm sure she'll be back next week. And I will I think next week we have a special episode. I believe next Ooh. Week is special episode week. So
is it?
It is. So the week after that,
it's already that time.
It is. It's not hard to believe. It's the, hard to believe, but it is that time. But yeah, hopefully, you know, as I've said before, I will always try to make as many appearances as I can right now. Time is just a little difficult for me, but I definitely am trying to make it happen whenever I can. So, Ri, hopefully I will be back with you, Sue, on this, and we can have all three of us back together doing a show.
Yes.
That would be an absolute blast. I love you. I miss you. You're kicking ass. You're doing so good. You're crushing this mom thing. Like, I knew you would. You and Danny both. What a dream team. All right, friends. I have had a blast being back, and I hope to be back soon. And until then, have fun. Take care. Buckle up. Drink your water. Stay hydrated. All of those things. Bye.
Bye.
Mama Britt is lecturing your ass.
You just had to mention the water.
I did have to. That was for you.